Welcome to the first video of a series that will go over the Fallout Bible, which was a collection of writings by Chris Avellone, who was a prominent writer of the first two Fallouts and the much later Fallout New Vegas. This information was the beginning of formally compiling all the known lore regarding the series, which at this point consisted of Fallout and Fallout 2. Chris answers fan questions, clarifies certain confusing aspects of Fallout lore, and explains in detail a Fallout timeline. This video and the series as a whole is meant to be an easily digestible way to become familiar with the Bible and the content that it holds, and was inspired by a channel called Retcon Raider that went over all the design documents related to the unreleased Fallout 3 game, known as Van Buren, in a very straightforward and digestible way. His series, going over the design documents of Van Buren, is the most accessible way to understand what the game was meant to be, based on what evidence we have left from the incomplete design process. Seriously, it is a great series, and any one of you who have a passing interest should give it a shot. I will put his channel in the comments. So with that lengthy intro out of the way, let's dive into the Fallout Bible. The first installment of the Fallout Bible was released on January 15th, 2002, and started with a page of Fallout background information and a few pictures that served as promotional material for E3. The content was written as follows. The United Nations failed in 2052 as the planet's natural resources dried up, causing many smaller nations to go financially bankrupt and fail. Europe and the Middle East were cast into a long, drawn-out war over the few remaining productive oil fields. In late 2053, the United States closed its borders, when a new super plague is discovered and when a terrorist nuclear weapon destroys Tel Aviv. In early 2054, the US responds by creating Project Safe House. This project, financed by junk bonds, is responsible for creating large underground survival shelters, commonly known as vaults. This project is not completed when it runs out of money 9 years later. In 2060, the Middle Eastern oil fields run dry, ending the European War. In the winter of 2066, China attacks Alaska over what could be the last drops of oil in the world. The US responds with force, but it will be 10 years before the conflict is over. In a desperate maneuver, both superpowers invade neighboring countries in an effort to bolster their dwindling resources. The US annexation of Canada is concluded by late 2076. Canadian timber provides fuel for US military needs, and Alaska is reclaimed by early 2077. In the early morning hours of Saturday, October 23rd, 2077, the sky was filled with nuclear missiles. No one knows who started the war, but after 2 hours of nuclear devastation, no one cared. Because of frequent false alarms, few made it to the vaults when the final alarm sounded. Most people were trapped outside the closing vault doors. This was some of the material provided for the 1996 E3, which also included an early E3 demo of what was supposedly Shady Sands, but was a simplified version of the town with basic characters and a quest to show off the mechanics of the game. At this point in time, the game's special system was named GURPS because of the initial agreement to use the Generic Universal Role-Playing System developed by Steve Jackson Games. When this fell through, the special system was created in-house, and Fallout is all the better for this change. I find it interesting that at this point the term resource wars was not officially given, and instead the conflict between Europe and the Middle East is known as the European War. Also, when speaking about the new plague, it is not referred to by such a name, and the word they used, discovered, makes it seem like it naturally manifested itself instead of being a disease that had been researched. They either meant to keep these details intentionally vague, or they hadn't fleshed out the lore to the point that we have today. The next section contains disclaimers from Chris covering a few different things. First, he makes it known that this effort behind the Bible is a rough draft, and that there are bound to be lore inconsistencies, and that he will work to reconcile them as fans bring contradictions to his attention. He then assures readers that he is getting emails from them, and reading them even if he doesn't have time to respond to all of them individually. He then says that some information will be incomplete in the Bible for good reason. Either they are things that they want to explore in future games, or simply don't want to elaborate on and paint themselves into a metaphorical corner. He says that he also likes to see fan theories and fiction that comes out of the intentional holes in the lore. He gave a spoiler warning for those who haven't played the games, and it would be prudent of me to do so as well, so ye be warned. He then talks about when he will be working on the next entry, and that he will try to find a way to create a PDF version. That might sound silly, but remember, this is 2002, so let's cut him some slack. Chris then outlines the contents of this particular entry, which includes 3 fan questions, all documented known vaults and their experiments at that point in time from one of their developers, Tim Kaine, and the first attempt on his part at a Fallout timeline. Starting with the questions, Chris was asked, why was it that so many ghouls left Necropolis between Fallout 1 and 2 to settle in Broken Hills and Gecko? Is Necropolis empty now? Also, why was it that Harold joined the ghouls? I remember him talking as if he weren't a ghoul. When you type in ghouls in the question box in the first Fallout, he refers to the ghouls as them. If you remember, Necropolis was the place the character first encounters ghouls in the first Fallout, and in Fallout 2, they primarily lived in Broken Hills and Gecko. Harold has been a common character as well, and became a tree rooted into the ground in Fallout 3. Chris responded in a few parts. Ghouls still have the human need to expand and move on, and in 80 plus years between Fallout 1 and 2, the ghouls spread out from Necropolis in all directions, and some had even left before the events in Fallout 1. Necropolis is not empty now. Ghouls are still said to reside there, though Set is no longer their leader. It is not clear whether he is alive or dead. Harold joined the ghouls in Fallout 2 because Harold is a kindly sort who likes to help people. When he sees a group of people trying to make their way in the wasteland, he tries to step in and give them a leg up, especially when it can benefit life for everyone. Wherever a key event in Fallout has occurred, Harold always seems to be right there in the middle of things, helping to push the world along and make it a better place. His wit is a little dry and raspy, but he's got a good heart. Harold is not a ghoul, but he is a mutant. What happened to him inside the military base during his assault with Francine, Mark, and Richard Gray is unknown. But it is likely he was exposed to the FEV virus and changed. His last known memory after the attack was passing out and then waking up in the wasteland. Changed. So from these answers, we don't learn much about Harold that we didn't already know. Although he certainly looked ghoulish in the first Fallouts, he was distinct and definitely set apart by the tree growing on his head. This obviously ends with him in the Capital Wasteland being the nucleus of the Oasis and worshipped by the Tree Minders. This could be an erroneous interpretation of Chris's answer, but he almost makes it seem like all the ghouls in the Fallout 2 locations of Gecko and Broken Hills came from Necropolis, implying that ghouls are uncommon except for in Necropolis. This may not be a correct interpretation, but it would show that ghoulification was not seen as being widespread across the wastes of the US and affected only isolated populations. The second question is, does FEV really cause sterility? In Fallout 1, it seemed like the answer was a resounding yes, and a number of reasons for this were given by Zax and Vree. But then in Fallout 2, after you take Marcus to the cat's paw, he says, I hope she doesn't get pregnant, and says that the FEV doesn't make mutants go sterile, it just makes it take a few years to get the juices flowing again. Moreover, the Death Claws in Vault 13 were infected with FEV, and yet they were able to reproduce. So, does the FEV cause sterility or not? This question addresses a very important point and something that completely foiled the Master's plan in the first Fallout. If the player had a high enough charisma, they could potentially convince the Master to abandon his plans by convincing him that the super mutants were sterile and therefore could not reproduce and truly be the natural inheritors of this scared new world. However, some statements from the Fallout 2 companion Marcus cast that entire supposition in question. Chris responded by saying, FEV causes sterility in some creatures. FEV does cause sterility in super mutants and ghouls. Marcus's comment in New Reno was a joke only, and it was an inappropriate one, for which I apologize for. For other creatures, however, the FEV does not cause sterility. In fact, it may actually speed up their reproductive cycles, in tandem with potential drawbacks. Known species that can reproduce after being mutated with FEV include most species of giant rats, the mantises, who are known to have bred so fast they cover the Salt Lake City area like blankets, the Rad Scorpions, and the Death Claws. This is only a partial list. The Death Claws in Vault 13 are a special case. As part of the Enclave experiments, they were bred as fighting packs for the government. They were not supposed to be able to reproduce, but they were attempting to do so at the time of Fallout 2. It is extremely likely that the Enclave scientists would not have wanted the Death Claws to breed on their own for fear of losing control over them. That doesn't mean that they would have made mistakes in engineering limiters or sterility in them. The Wanamingos are a result of FEV virus experiments, but they are sterile. They are not aliens, but word is they were designed as FEV-tailored weapons for waging war on other countries, and they got loose. They do live a long time, but they were dying out at the time of Fallout 2. They have only been sighted in the Fallout 2 area and nowhere else in the wastelands. This response is interesting for a few reasons. Firstly, FEV is said to be the reason for a lot of different mutations for many different creatures in the wasteland. Often this is in tandem with radiation, but it isn't clear where one starts and the other ends. FEV was released into the atmosphere when the West Tech Research Facility took a direct hit from one or more nuclear weapons. Many of the creatures Chris listed as being the result of FEV are found throughout the United States, so either there were multiple facilities that released FEV after the Great War, these FEV mutated creatures were very successful in their post-war landscape and spread wide and far, or FEV has a lot less to do with their mutations than radiation. His comments about the Wanamingos are also interesting because, for one, there is a way for them to reproduce, which, in a later Bible entry, he clarifies that he was wrong, and we will cover that in a future video. He also seems to imply that before the Enclave were working on weaponizing and controlling Death Claws, that they, in their very early days, or the US government before them, created the Wanamingos. I say this because there is no longer any active work within the Enclave on the Wanamingos, and also that their express purpose was to wage war on other countries, which, after the Great War, is no longer a goal. It is hard to wage war with other countries when your own has been completely decimated, and you don't even have full control of it yourself. Not to mention, we have no idea what countries may not exist anymore. Wanamingos have not been seen in any other Fallout games like Chris suggests in his answer, but there is some Fallout 3 concept art of a mutated version of Wanamingos. The third question is, are the Rad Scorpions a product of the FEV virus? When you talk to the Dr. Raslow in Shady Sands, he tells you that they were once American Emperor Scorpions, but that he has no idea how they mutated, because radiation alone couldn't have done it. For that matter, what about all the other creatures of the wasteland? Which ones have been mutated by FEV, and which ones haven't? Maybe in the bestiary, each creature could have a stat that shows its level of FEV infection. So Raslow is a doctor in the first Fallout that lives in Junktown. Although Chris touched on this in his previous answers, he states more explicitly with the following. The Rad Scorpions are a result of a combination of radiation with the FEV virus, and Raslow in Shady Sands is correct. They were originally Emperor Scorpions that have grown big. FEV-infected creatures in the wasteland include almost all the ones you have seen in Fallout 1 and 2. Mantises, most species of rats, gecko lizards, Brahmin, scorpions, ants, various varieties of plants including the Venus flytrap. Rumor has it some dogs were affected, but no one's seen any. So for now, that's just a rumor. Of course, the centaurs are a mash of human, dog, and various other parts. But hey, who knows how that mutation came about? Gray was probably messing around in one of his labs. Creatures not mutated by FEV probably did not survive the aftermath of the Great War, with the possible exception of cockroaches, and perhaps normal ants, though there are FEV-infected versions of these species. No one knows where those bird noises in Vault City came from. I'll try to include a chart of FEV-infected creatures in future editions, as well as other critters that you may have not seen in Fallout 1 and 2. Most likely, a great majority of insects were affected. They tend to breed much faster, and their mutations tend to become evident pretty quickly as the generations advance. Possibly beetles, some spiders, cockroaches, and other creatures. There are a few interesting points made here. One, I'm not sure if I correctly interpret his sentence about dogs. He says some dogs were affected, but no one has seen any, so it's just a rumor. We have, of course, seen dogs in both Fallouts, so perhaps he's referring to mutated dogs. This is also interesting given how dogs were to play a pretty large role in the proposed Fallout 3, with Denver being completely overrun by them. He also suggests that no animals that hadn't been altered by FEV in some form likely survived the Great War, which would suggest that all living life forms have some level of change wrought by the FEV infection, and perhaps validating the previous thought that FEV mutated creatures did have a distinct competitive advantage over non-infected creatures. And that is why they spread all over the wasteland. I find his comment on the bird noises in Vault City peculiar because I did not see any reference to that in the original question, so perhaps this was added in there because he had been asked the question before. Birds are not featured anywhere in Fallout or Fallout 2, but can be seen from Fallout 3 on. Chris mentions that Vault Tech appeared in a hyphenated form and an unhyphenated form in Fallout and Fallout 2. He sets the record straight that the correct way is with a hyphen. The next section is about vaults within the games, where it is explained that two places within Fallout 2 were meant to hint toward the sinister plot to use vaults as experiments. In Vault 8, located in Vault City, the player can uncover a classified document, and with a sufficient science skill, open a file detailing the purpose of Vault 8 was to be a control vault and to open, quote, on time. Similarly, using science, once again, can uncover the history of Vault 13, where the Vault Dweller was expelled from the vault after saving it by finding a water chip, because the Overseer thought he would ruin the experiment. Indeed, the Overseer of Vault 13 did something that caused many people to leave the vault and die, after which he was sentenced by fellow Vault Dwellers to death, and the title of Overseer was never used again. Now, this is all important because in the first Fallout, there was no notion of anything sinister behind the vaults other than surviving the nuclear apocalypse. Fallout 2 introduced that concept from the intro and dropped hints along the way to give the vaults more depth and give Fallout one of its truly unique aspects that is always eagerly anticipated in new releases. Chris goes on to give a record of all the known vaults from that point in the Fallout series history. Obviously, this is missing a lot of vaults introduced in newer games. Vault 8, a control vault intended to open and recolonize the surface after 10 years. Vault City is the result, unfortunately. Apparently, Chris is not a fan. Vault 12, in order to study the effects of radiation on the selected population, the vault was designed not to close. This is the Necropolis Vault, and the ghouls were the result. Vault 13 intended to stay closed for 200 years as a study of prolonged isolation. The broken water chip forced the Overseer to improvise and use the Vault Dweller as a pawn. Later study of Vault 13 records by the Enclave led them to their current plan to end the war. Vault 15 intended to stay closed for 50 years and include people of radically diverse ideologies. Gathered from what you hear from Eridesh in Fallout 1, he has quite a bit of multicultural flavoring to his speech. Vault 27. This vault would be overcrowded deliberately. 2,000 people would be assigned to enter, double the total sustainable amount. The location of this vault is unknown. Vault 29. No one in this vault was over the age of 15 when they entered. Parents were redirected to other vaults on purpose. Harold is believed to have come from this vault. Vault 34. The armory was overstocked with weapons and ammo and not provided with a lock. Vault 36. The food extruders were designed to produce only a thin, watery gruel. Vault 42, no light bulbs of more than 40 watts were provided. Vault 53, most of the equipment was designed to break down every few months. While repairable, the breakdowns were intended to stress the inhabitants unduly. Vault 55, all entertainment tapes were removed. Vault 56, all entertainment tapes were removed except those of one particularly bad comic actor. Sociologists predicted failure before Vault 55. Vault 68. Of the 1,000 people who entered, there was only one woman. Vault 69. Of the 1,000 people who entered, there was only one man. Vault 70. All jumpsuit extruders fail after 6 months. Vault 106. Psychoactive drugs were released into the air filtration system 10 days after the door was sealed. Chris then goes on to say that there is a rumor that there are 122 vaults that were constructed, and for fan fiction purposes, the majority do not have any information. As of the present moment in this series, we can say a few things about these vaults. Vault 8 to 15 featured in Fallout and Fallout 2, as described. Vault 27, that was intentionally overcrowded, is only ever mentioned here in the Bible and nowhere else in the games. Vault 29 is on the West Coast and was meant to feature in Van Buren, but only got a mention in Fallout 76, therefore confirming its existence. Vault 34 featured in New Vegas and was the origin of the Boomers. Vault 36, that only had terrible watered-down food and its existence has never been verified. Vault 42, that only provided low wattage lights, has not been confirmed outside of the Bible. Vault 53, that intentionally had things break down, was only mentioned in the Fallout Bible, and a person in a Vault 53 jumpsuit made it into the concept art of Fallout 3. Vault 55, that had no entertainment, has not been confirmed outside of the Bible. Vault 56, that didn't have entertainment except for one terrible comedic actor, also has had its existence never verified. Vault 68, with 1,000 men and one woman, and Vault 69, with 1,000 women and one man, have not been confirmed outside of the Bible either. Vault 70 didn't provide people with new jumpsuits in a vault predominantly populated by Mormons, which is honestly pretty funny. The existence of this vault has not been confirmed outside of the Bible. Vault 106 introduced psychoactive drugs to the inhabitants and can be explored in Fallout 3. It is interesting to see which vaults have been confirmed by later games, and which ones have not had any mention. Truthfully, some of them sound like meme vaults from a particularly sleep-deprived brainstorming event over at Interplay. The next section is the first attempt at making an official timeline. Later Bible entries make amendments to this timeline, so I won't go over this timeline in its entirety every single video. However, I will go over it here so that we have a basis for future videos and to reflect what the state of knowledge was at this particular point in time. 2051. Seeking to protect business interests and their oil supply, the United States begins to exert increasing pressure on Mexico, citing the political instability and pollution stemming from Mexico as a threat to the U.S. Various economic sanctions serve to destabilize Mexico, and the United States military enters Mexico to keep the oil refineries running and making sure oil and fuel continue to make their way north across the border at Mexico's expense. 2052, a television documentary into the withered husk of the Texas oil fields, brings the oil shortage into the American households and reveals how deep the energy crisis runs. 2052, in April, the resource wars begin. Many smaller nations go bankrupt, and Europe, dependent on oil imports from the Middle East, responds to the Middle East's rising oil prices with military action. The long drawn-out war between the European Commonwealth and the Middle East begins. 2052, May through July, the United Nations already suffering begin to collapse. In a series of heated debates, many nations withdraw from the organization as the UN tries to keep the peace. At the end of July, the United Nations is disbanded. 2053, the socially transmitted new plague arises, killing tens of thousands. The United States closes its borders and the first ever national quarantine is declared. The source of the plague is unknown, but rumors persist that it is a genetically engineered weapon. 2053 in December, like an exclamation mark on the end of a very bad year, a terrorist nuclear weapon destroys Tel Aviv. January of 2054, a limited nuclear exchange in the Middle East raises fears throughout the world. 2054, in light of the Euro-Middle Eastern conflict and the plague scare, the United States begins plans on Project Safe House. The project, financed by junk bonds, is designed to create shelters, also called vaults, for the populace in the event of a nuclear war or deadly plague. Construction begins in late 2054 and proceeds rapidly due to advances in construction technology. ZAX 1.0 goes online, developed by Vault-Tec. Initially a prototype of some of the systems designed to govern the vaults, it is given to the government to help the Department of Energy collect resource data. Within a year, it is taken by the military for plague and tactical research. 2055. FSEF, actual name of organization is unknown, the acronym is not defined in the timeline, start working on a new virus to kill the new plague. This virus is the FEV1, Forced Evolutionary Virus. 2055, ZAX 1.2 is brought in to regulate conditions in FSEF, parentheses, the GLOW. It is not part of the Vault-Tec preservation software, so it does not have any orders to protect humanity after the bombs fall. 2057, a strain of FEV is tested on animals. 2059, the Anchorage front line is established as the United States increases its military presence in Alaska to protect its oil interests. The Anchorage front line causes tensions in the United States and Canada, as the United States attempts to pressure Canada into allowing American military units to guard the Alaskan pipeline. The first artificial intelligence is born. Limited by memory constraints, its expansion is rapidly halted. The discovery paves the way for future AI research in laboratories throughout the United States. 2060, traffic on the streets of the world stops moving. Fuel becomes too precious to waste on automobiles, so alternatives are explored. Electric infusion cars begin to be manufactured, but factories can only make limited amounts. Pressure on fusion research increases. The Euro-Middle Eastern War ends as the oil fields in the Middle East run dry. There's no longer a goal in the conflict, and both sides are reduced almost to ruin. Initial tests of the new FEV are almost complete. Higher primates seem to survive, gaining intelligence. 2062, new plague continues to spread. Scientists in FSEF are amazed at what they find out about FEV. It is carried by the bloodstream and seems to eradicate all imperfections it finds. It also seems to fill in gaps in the DNA sequence with new information. Animals become smarter, body mass increases, and they become more aggressive. 2063, the construction of the vaults completed. Drills begin in many cities, and the increasing frequency of the drills has a cry wolf effect, and the turnouts for drills trickle off as the years go on. 2065, due to enormous demands for electricity in the summer of 2065, a nuclear reactor in New York City almost goes critical. The near meltdown brings into effect power rationing, and the term hot summer is used to refer to the New York incident. Increasing need for mobility in the United States, mechanized cavalry leads to the military to focus the efforts on creating a man-based tank, essentially a two-legged walking armored unit, power armor. Between 2065 and 2067, power armor research grows and several prototypes are developed, many of which prove to be unworkable in the field. These prototypes pave the way for future advances in both military and construction technology. As the oil resources dry up across the globe, China's fossil fuel dependency causes an energy crisis in the nation. China, bordering on collapse, becomes more aggressive in its trade talks with the United States. Unwilling to export oil to China, talks between the United States and China break down. Adding further insult to the Chinese-American relations, the first crude fusion cell is unveiled, one of the results of the Power Armor project. Devices designed for the fusion cell begin to be manufactured. Incorporating fusion power into the general US infrastructure begins. But the process is too slow to supply power to the regions that need it. Nearly 13 years later, few sections of the United States were supplied with fusion power. In the winter, China invades Alaska. The Anchorage front line becomes a true battleground. As a sign of increasing tension between the two countries, Canada proves reluctant to allow American troops on Canadian soil, or allow American planes to fly over Canadian airspace. The United States and Canadian tensions rise, but Canada eventually backs down, and US troops pass through Canada. This sets the stage for the Canadian annexation in 2076. 2067, the first suit of power armor is deployed in Alaska. While lacking the full mobility of future versions, this power armor is incredibly effective against Chinese tanks and infantry. Its ability to carry heavy ordnance becomes key in various localized conflicts, and it has the power to destroy entire towns without endangering the wearer. China rushes to create its own versions, but they are many years behind the United States. 2069, Canada begins to feel the pressure from the United States military as the US draws upon Canadian resources for the war effort. Vast stretches of timberland are destroyed, and other resources in Canada are stretched to the breaking point. Many Americans refer to Canada as Little America, and Canadian protests are unheard. 2070, the first of the Chrysler motor fusion-driven cars are developed. Reassuringly, big and American, the limited models carry a hefty price tag but are sold out within days. Many Chrysler plants have long since been converted into making military ordnance. 2071, once the military applications of the virus become known, the FEV research being conducted in the GLOW is relocated to a military base in southwestern California, the military base in Fallout 1, also called Base Omega. The project at the FSEF, or GLOW, is put on hold due to the condition of the subjects. Animals seem to be regressing, becoming dumber, but their body mass remains high. 2072, several animal test subjects at the GLOW suddenly attack in a pack, killing four scientists. They are all killed by security and the remaining animals are separated, drugged, and watched closely. The United States' increasing demand for Canadian resources causes protests and riots in several Canadian cities. An attempted sabotage attempt at the Alaskan pipeline is all the military needs as an excuse to begin its annexation of Canada, which in fact has already begun in 2067. Contrary to their claim of seeking only to retake Alaska from the Reds, American power armor units, infantry, and mechanized divisions are deployed to China. But they make slow progress on the mainland, putting a further drain on American resources and supply lines. 2075, FEV research resumes at FSEF in an attempt to find out why the animal subjects survived when many human patients did not. Scientists engineer the virus further. 2075, research on FEV1 begins in small quarantine towns in North America. Early results are positive, but within 2 months, the subjects become victims, displaying deformities and insanity. 2076, the United States annexation of Canada is complete. Canadian protesters and rioters are shot on sight, and the Alaskan pipeline swarms with American military units. Pictures of atrocities make their way to the United States, causing further unrest and protests. Power Armor prototype is completed, resulting in the Power Armor players find in Fallout 1. This is the pinnacle of Power Armor technology before the Great War. Many of these units are sent to China, and they begin to carve a swath through the Chinese forces. The Chinese resources are strained to the breaking point, and the supply lines from the nations China has annexed begin to break down. FEV research is leaked to the world, raising tensions even further and causing many countries to withdraw support for the United States. FEV is carried back to a secret base, and all records of the project are ordered destroyed. News blackouts begin. Food and energy riots begin in major cities throughout the United States. Military units begin to be deployed in cities within the United States to contain rioters, and many temporary jails are constructed. A state of emergency is declared, and martial law soon follows. 2077, Alaska is reclaimed, and the Anchorage front line is again held by Americans. The first domestic use of power armor within the United States for crowd and quarantine control. Units originally serving in China and the Anchorage front line find themselves fighting Americans at home. Food riots increase, and many civilians are killed. Several soldiers defect from the military both in Canada and the United States. They are captured and are sent to the military prisons. FEV research nears completion. Protests in many major cities and governments around the world, as well as accusations that the US was responsible for the new plague. The new virus, FEV, is seen as a threat and serves only to fuel tensions. Prepared for a nuclear attack from China, the president and the enclave retreats to remote sections around the globe and make the contingency plans for continuing the war. Bombs are launched. Who struck first is unknown, and it is not known if the bombs came from China or America. Air raid sirens sound, but very few people go into the vaults, thinking it is a false alarm. The vaults are sealed. Necropolis Vault, Vault 12, never closes. Once it becomes known that the other vaults have sealed, people within Bakersfield attempt to force their way into Vault 12 to protect themselves and their families. The FSEF research facility is hit by a nuclear warhead, breaking open the FEV research tanks and releasing it into the atmosphere. Once exposed to radiation, it begins to mutate and infect humans and critters in the wasteland. 2078 to 2088, the military base, Base Omega, survives, the soldiers and scientists within protected from the radiation and FEV flooding the wasteland. 2080, the first effects of the virus are seen in the survivors. Widespread mutations occur with animals and humans alike. Those that survive the effects of the mutations are permanently changed by the virus. New species are created almost overnight. 2082, scientists in Base Omega select a new goal and begin to try and make the perfect survivor. They attempt to tailor the FEV, creating FEV2. They become increasingly secretive, isolating themselves from the soldiers. 2083, the city of Necropolis, founded by the ghoul survivors of Vault 12 and the US citizens that fled to Bakersfield when the bombs fell. 2084, Set takes control of Necropolis, wresting control from the original overseer. The Vault 12 overseer is driven north and never heard from again. 2088, when it is discovered that the scientists in Base Omega are testing the new strains of FEV on the soldiers rebel. Under the leadership of General Roger Maxon, they wipe out the scientists, but in the resulting firefight, one of the FEV canisters is ruptured. Fearing contamination, the soldiers seal the base, then head out into the desert, taking supplies and weapon schematics with them. This event is called the Exodus, and the surviving soldiers went on to eventually form the Brotherhood of Steel. 2089, the Brotherhood of Steel begins establishing a small bunker in the wasteland, their headquarters in Fallout 1. Originally nothing more than a simple concrete bunkhouse, the Brotherhood of Steel began to excavate subchambers, slowly building it into a fortress to withstand raider attacks. 2091, Vault 8 opens, and they use their Gek to create fertile ground for their city. This becomes Vault City. 2092, LA Vault opens, the Boneyard is founded and attracts survivors. Dr. Richard Moreau is exiled from Vault City for murder. The circumstances surrounding the murder are unknown, but he changes his last name to Gray and heads south. 2093, the Hub is founded by a man named Angus who sets up camp around a filthy oasis in the desert, and he proceeds to begin trading with other settlements. 2096, Vault 29 opens. Harold, now human, sets out to make his fortune as a trader, then caravan boss. Increasing mutant attacks cause him to form one of the first adventuring parties of Fallout to try and find out where the mutants are coming from. 2099, John Maxon, the future High Elder in the Brotherhood of Steel in Fallout 1, is born. 2102, Richard Gray's expedition, including Harold, finds the military base/Base Omega and the expedition is scattered and defeated by mutants at the base. Gray is knocked into one of the vats of FEV by a robotic arm, and Harold is knocked unconscious, only to awaken later out in the wasteland. 2102. Richard Gray, now horribly mutated by the virus, arises from the vats and begins his plans for the Unity and the Master Race. He gains the name The Master. 2120. The Master starts experiments into the FEV2. Over the next few years, his experiments produce breeds of strange mutants, but only around 2137 do his results begin to bear fruit, and the super mutants are born. 2120, Angus rules over the growing hub and establishes himself as governor. 2125, Angus is murdered. Hub is thrown into chaos. 2126, a band of merchants seizes the water tower in the hub. They demand anyone wanting water must pay a toll. The Great Merchant Wars begin. 2126 to 2128, the Great Merchant Wars are fought. The water merchants seal up the town but are outnumbered. A man named Green, a police officer, makes the peace and negotiates a settlement. The Central Council is formed. 2130, the Great Winter occurs. 2134, a faction within the Brotherhood of Steel gains strength and they urge the elders to end their seclusion. The Divisionist group splits away from the Brotherhood of Steel, taking some technology and weapons with them, and the old keys to Base Omega. 2135, Roger Maxon dies of cancer and John Maxon takes up the role of general within the Brotherhood of Steel. FEV2 research completed. Master begins gathering test subjects, willing or unwilling, from local human stock, usually caravans. The first super mutant emerges from the vat during this year. For many years, the caravan disappearances are blamed on monsters in the desert, and even when the abductions begin to occur on hub caravans, the Deathclaws are blamed. 2137, the Master begins to mass produce super mutants. Only about 1 in 6 or 1 in 5 attempts are successful, and of these successes, only half seem to last to go on to part of his growing army, now called the Unity. 2140, Decker forms underground in the hub and starts pulling strings. 2141, Vault 15 opened. Vault Dweller is born. Raiders begin to form in the region as food supplies run low. The Khans and the Vipers begin terrorizing local settlements. 2142, Shady Sands is founded, wall erected against the Raiders. 2145, cute little Tandy is born, unaware that by the time Fallout 2 rolls around, she will turn into a wizened old crone that is difficult to look at. 2151, the Brotherhood of Steel sends out a group to find out what happened to the Brotherhood exiles, but finds only ruins in the wasteland and no survivors. 2152, as their influence spreads through the wastes, the Master finds humans, doomsday cultists, and rather than dip them in the vats, he demands their obedience as spies. Their leader is a man named Morpheus, and he pledges his followers to the Master. Morpheus and his cultists form the future core of the Children of the Cathedral. 2055 to 56, after capturing a caravan of strange garbed travelers, vault dwellers, the Master learns the location of the Boneyard Vault, the future site of the Cathedral. He conquers the inhabitants and sets up operations there, and the human cultists begin to use the vaults as their power base. Within the vault, the Master learns of other vaults, and realizing their human occupants are ripe for transformation, begins to send out patrols to vault locations in search of these other vaults. 2156, the Master sees advantages in establishing a benevolent religion, the Children of the Cathedral, and using them as spies in settlements throughout the wastes. Missionaries from the Children of the Cathedral spread slowly across the wasteland, acting as eyes and ears for Morpheus and the Master. 2157, the Master learns the location of the Bakersfield Vault, Vault 14, and sends a detachment of super mutants there to seize the vault. Many ghouls perish in the attack, and Set finally parleys with the super mutants, telling them that the ghouls are the vault survivors that the super mutants are looking for. The super mutants, angered at failing to find an intact vault, set up a garrison in the watershed to watch the inhabitants and ensure Set's cooperation in the war to come. 2161, the vault dwellers kicked out of Vault 13 to find a replacement watership. The vault dweller discovers Shady Sands and meets Tandy. 2162, the vault dweller destroys the military base. The vault dweller kicks the Master's ass. The vault dweller returns to Fallout 13 only to be driven out. Some members of the vault leave in search of him not long afterwards. 2165, vault dweller removes his vault suit and from this day forward never wears it again. Vault dweller founds the small village of Arroyo. 2167, construction of Arroyo is completed. 2185, at high noon, Marcus and the Brotherhood of Steel Paladin Jacob cross paths many, many miles southwest of Broken Hills and fight for a few days. Eventually they give up, unable to get an advantage over the other. The two start traveling together, arguing over Master and Brotherhood of Steel doctrine. Marcus and Jacob, along with a trail of ghouls, humans, and super mutants, found the community of Broken Hills. 2176, Jacob moves on, says goodbye to Marcus, then vanishes forever. 2186, New California Republic formed, and a central council is created as a governing body. 2188, Vault Dweller has a daughter, who becomes the Elder in Fallout 2. 2195, Enclave scouts discover the remains of the military base and find it partially destroyed. Enclave scientists and Chemical Corps scour the remains of the base, while assault squads, including Soldier Frank Horgan, 25 at the time, comb the desert for slaves they can use to mine the military base and get to the vats. Enclave construction crews and super mutant slaves begin excavations. They uncover the FEV virus, and mutations begin to occur. Frank Horgan comes into contact with the FEV and is sent to the Enclave labs for study. Enclave, having obtained the FEV data, abandons the military base site after more mutations occur, causing second-generation super mutants to arise. Super mutant slaves are abandoned in the base, and the group forms a new community led by Melchior. 2195 to 2220, Horrigan gradually mutates from exposure to FEV, gaining the physique and slow, stupid, single-mindedness of a super mutant. He is kept heavily sedated, operated on, and studied for many, many years. He is conscious for only brief periods at a time, then quickly sedated after the bloodshed is over. 2196, Tandy unanimously elected president of the NCR by the NCR Council. 2198, Enclave works on various new technologies, including power armor variations. None of these are much of an improvement over the conventional old power armor, and some are actually worse. 2208, Vault Dweller vanishes from Arroyo, presumed dead, and he leaves his vault suit behind, folded on his bed. Some say he was taken by the sky spirits, others say he felt it was his time to move on. The 1 moon-month cycle of mourning for the Vault Dweller ends, and activity in Arroyo begins to return to normal. Final training of the Vault Dweller's daughter for the role of Village Elder begins. She undergoes a great deal of physical training and tutoring in various sciences, mathematics, and of course, weapon skills. 2210, Vault Dweller's daughter takes her mystic test, a key ingredient of which is several pots worth of hallucinogenic plants from Hakuin's garden. She runs the gauntlet in the Temple of Trials, using her charm to pass the tests. She offers numerous criticisms of the test, resulting in many revisions. Vault Dweller's daughter ascends to role of Village Elder. She rules with a steady hand and her wisdom is greatly respected. 2215, Congressman Richardson rises to power within the Enclave, aided by pressure from his father, President Richardson. Under presidential order, Enclave scientists begin to work on an upgraded version of power armor. Many prototypes are developed and tested. 2220, Congressman Richardson is elected president for the first term of five, through aid and political pressure by his father. Enclave scientists develop a reliable version of Mark II power armor. The prototype results and accidents and explosions and deaths are classified by the order of the president for the sake of morale. 2221, tests begin to run dry on Frank Horgan. It is suggested that he be used as a field operative and be used in tests in the wasteland against local populations. The Chosen One is born. The Chosen One's father is not recorded in the tribal records. The reason for this is unknown, but the elder may have simply been embarrassed. 2231, Frank Horgan is manufactured for his new role. A new version of power armor is built to accommodate his mass, and he is sealed inside. After a few horrifically successful field tests, Horrigan becomes the Enclave solution to numerous sticky problems. 2235, the Enclave experiments on Deathclaws, attempting to create special fighting units for waging war in hostile environments. Many of these experiments are tested against Horrigan. While there had already been a small number of ghouls in Gecko at this time, more come to the area, and the town of Gecko is formed. The new influx of ghouls brings scavenged technology and know-how, and the power plant in Gecko becomes operational later that year. Vault City looks upon their new neighbors with growing concern. 2238, Harold arrives in Gecko, and he does his best to help the ghouls with the running of the nuclear power plant. 2241, the worst dry season in many years causes a drought in the Northern California area, hurting crops and Brahmin in both Arroyo and Modoc. The first samples of Jet begin to arrive in Redding, courtesy of the Mordino family. Vault City rejects offers of an alliance with both the Bishop family of Nerino and NCR. Raider attacks on caravans to Vault City begin. Chosen One begins his mystic test, descending into the Temple of Trials. Chosen One leaves Arroyo in search of the Gek. 2242, Enclave sends a coded sequence to Vault 13, activating its central computer and declaring that it is time to leave the Vault. Martin Frobisher gathers the Vault Dwellers together for the tutorial movie. Less than a day later, they open the vault door to be greeted by a Verdi assault squad who kills three of the citizens who were resisting and storms the vault, seizing all the inhabitants. Enclave animal handlers drop a Deathclaw unit into Vault 13 from a safe distance to kill anyone investigating the vault, and cloak the Enclave's presence. Other Deathclaws are sent into the desert surrounding Vault 13 to check for any escapees or witnesses. 2242. The Chosen One enters the Enclave using the damaged tanker and destroys the Poseidon oil platform, killing the President of the United States and ending the Enclave's plans for world domination. I am glad that I don't have to do that again. There is a lot of content here, and a solid portion of it has changed or been invalidated because of later games. Rather than address all the points in this video, I want to evaluate the major differences in the Bible timeline and the official lore at the end of my series on the Fallout Bible, which will span several videos. That brings us to the end of this video, but the beginning of my comment highlights. A few of you asked a question along the same lines, essentially asking me how people could think transistors were never invented in the Fallout universe. I don't know exactly how the myth became so pervasive, but it was a fan theory that truthfully made a lot of sense, given what we know about Fallout's alternate history and the Adam Punk aesthetic. For all of you that seemed surprised that there are so many people that still think this is true, you must not read my video comments. I asked for feedback on covering Adam's shop items, and, like I expected, received a range of views. Some people were all for it, some people wanted me to act like Fallout 76 doesn't even exist, and others had more nuanced approaches. I think I may mention some Adam Shop content if it applies to the video and is interesting, particularly if it is an item that is returning from previous games, like the Brahmin carts I mentioned in my vehicle video. Several people referenced the flux capacitor from Back to the Future as being the symbol on the side of the Institute laser guns. While I don't actually think that's true, I want it to be true, and so it is now my new headcanon. Tom Prick Vixen dug out his old hard drive just to go do some footwork related to the buses he had previously mentioned in my vehicles video, and I really appreciate all his effort just to get better information about buses and Fallout. Definitely give his comment a read. And as a reminder, you guys are just awesome. Jeff the Reaper raised an interesting point when talking about Institute laser guns. He talks about a remark from Paladin Dance when doing the deep range transmitter quest. Upon discovering the destruction of the facility's robot guards, he mentions that there is no blood or spent ammunition casings. The no blood makes sense since they are synths, but Institute lasers use up energy cells just like normal laser rifles, and are discarded after reloading. This could be solid evidence that the Institute laser guns were not meant to take any ammo and be closer to weapons like the recharger pistol. I do agree with him that a weaker laser would seem like a good balance to a weapon that did not require ammo. No Time mentioned that the salvaged Assaultron head is referenced by an NPC in Fallout 76 to be activated by twisting a portion on the neck. What this means for how the robot operates isn't exactly clear, but I think No Time's interpretation is pretty reasonable. I want to thank everyone for their comments. There were a lot of good ones to read on the last video, and I apologize for not being able to highlight them all. Some are also being saved as a reference for future videos where I think the information is more applicable. If you are looking forward to the rest of this mini-series on the Fallout Bible, let me know, as I want to be giving you the kind of content that can hopefully present some new and interesting information and scratches that Fallout itch. Thanks everyone, and may you walk in Adam's glow.